Welcome to episode 2 of my conversation with Chuck Wentz of Grafton and Christian DeMarkin as we discuss the Battle of the Bulge. Day trip to history starts now. What did they discover that caused them to take him away to the prison?
Oh, that was strictly because he was an American citizen.
Strictly for his citizenship.
That he went to work that day and he never came back. And we found out afterwards, Dad told us, he was on his way back home and they arrested him and gone. But mother knew where he was because, see, in Belgium, the state troopers are called gendarmes. Mm-hmm. And the gendarmes, very patriotic. So they sent two on bicycle to the house and said, by the way, your husband is in our custody per orders of the Germans. So mother quickly made a package with some food and warm clothes and brought it over that night. They snuck her in to the jail. And that's the last time she saw him for 2.5 years.
For 2.5 years.
Yeah, he left home 184 pounds, came back 109.
And how did he come back from the Germans?
Because as long as the Germans were winning, they didn't care if Americans died in camp. They never tortured Americans. They didn't beat them, but they let them die of hunger. There was not enough food. Most of the young men died before the old men. So they were winning in Italy, they were winning in Africa, everything is fine. When Rommel lost Africa and now we were attacking Italy, the Germans, decided no American should die in camp for fear of reprisal. Mm-hmm. So the American doctor, Dr. Bobea, said to Dad, Gus, next time I know that there's gonna be an inspection, I'll give you 2 or 3 days notice. And you don't drink because you had a kidney removed in 1936. Now, if you don't drink, your last drop of urine will show that your last kidney is finished, is going. So you're a goner. And sure enough, he had an inspection late October 43, and they thought he was dying. They shipped him home, and he came home on a Sunday. We did not know it, of course.
Wow.
And by policy, it's not a policy. Just in respect for the people that were in German concentration camp, in church, the seats of every woman or man that was taken away stayed empty. So in our case, the first seat where Dad always sat was empty, then mother and the kids. Well, that Sunday, this hobo-looking man, skinny, with a beard, Dad had no beard, dirty-looking, dirty clothes, he sat down next to mother. Well, mother was not going to go gawk at him and say, well, what are you doing, right? She looked toward the altar. Well, us kids we all looked and said, why? There's plenty of seats. Why is this old man sitting next to mother? Within 30 seconds, he took his elbow and shoved it in her ribs, and they always spoke English between the two of them. And he said, are you going to kiss me? That's how she found out.
Yeah.
Very emotional.
Wow, I can imagine.
Yeah. And then she put him back on stream, and then he got caught a second time. But this time it was worse, because he got caught helping American airmen escape. That was automatically condemned to death.
Mm. So, wow. So how did he get out of that mess?
He was taken out of the house and literally disappeared. But we found out after when he was liberated that he was in the infamous prison of Saint-Gilles in Brussels. That was a German prison. And there were four men per cell, where the cell was for one man originally. And they were every single person in the prison, there were more than 1,500, were all condemned to death for or blowing up a tower, or sabotaging railroad, who knows.
Right.
And the Americans started entering Belgium on the 2nd of September. Yeah, but they were going so fast, the Germans put the prisoners on these little boxcars. Dad was lucky, there were only 92 men in that boxcar, but some of them were up to 110. And the train took off for Germany, because the Germans are kind of rigid. You're going to be shot on the 13th of September. That was Dad's execution date.
Right.
Not the 14th, not the 12th. So, all right, they're all heading for Germany. Luckily for them, three of the engineers, conductors, they were all Flemish-speaking underground, and they sabotaged that train. They lost the water. They had the bearing that went. Everything went wrong, one after the other.
Right.
And they were able to be forced by the German to a cul-de-sac. They went up one way, east another time, and tried. So finally they fell in a cul-de-sac, and the Germans, luckily, were not SS. They panicked and they ran. And the prisoners broke the doors and they ran too.
Mm.
So all 1,500 plus escaped.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So Dad walked back home through the woods, and just as we were being strafed, we were going through one of the best strafing I've ever seen in my life. That was the P-47 Thunderbolt, and they were coming down unbelievable, low. The sun was shining, and as their guns were, the 50 caliber were firing, you'd swear it was a rod of copper coming out of the shining. It was very impressive.
Mm.
Oh, they got the Germans big time that day.
Mm. So because the battle was fluid, and because men like you may or may not have known where they were at the time, you told me the story of walking around on patrol, and you ended up someplace you didn't want to be. Tell us about that.
Was that one time I was on duty at night. We when I get on duty, well, a couple of us were supposed to stand guard, but we didn't know the feel or what it was around. And when it got dark, we had to walk back and forth. But you could probably think that you could just run 5 yards and it'd be the Germans, Duncan. You didn't know. I was walking back and forth with this guy, and he was walking. We'd meet, and then we'd go back and forth. And we, like I said, I thought of like the old World War days where they come behind you, cut your patrol. So I was pretty scared that night.
Mm.
And we kind of got together more or less and walked apart. And another time, Chris knows that I don't know if it was an officer said there might be some patrol come through that night with digger machine guns, because I was in the models of machine guns. So we went down to dig a machine gun. We didn't have the machine gun. We dug a spot for it. And we got halfway through. Turned around, like I told the guy, was it, look behind him. We looked behind, there's five Germans standing over us. And the way we got out of that, through artillery, whoever it was watching us from a way distance.
Your buddies.
They threw shells over us. And when the Germans heard the shells going, they ran and ducked. And we, instead of running and duck, we looked at each other and said, let's go.
Yeah.
And I told you, we were running so fast, my legs couldn't keep up with me.
So you were captured for about 5 minutes?
Yeah, well, I can't say five or eight, but between the time they stopped and looked over you, But I can remember running. I know my legs were going so fast. And when I got over this mound, I think it was like you see the movies where the legs go like that. So I made a dive, and when I did, I could hear the bullets going like ting, ting, ting. And I went over the mound, and we crawled back up in the hill. And then one of the guys, what the hell are you guys doing now? He says, oh, we seen what's going on. We threw a barrage over there, so we got out of there. But there's no big deal, just over and get back over right. it.
And even though you were captured at bayonet point, you didn't qualify as a prisoner of war.
No, we didn't run back and say, well, we want a medal for
right,
that. No.
Right.
Well, we had a lot of guys get wounded that never got purple hearts for it.
Right.
The ones that got hurt bad, they deserve it. They get back. But when you got, I got hit in here and there, and a couple other guys got shells in that, and didn't put in for purple hearts. Mm.
You mentioned that you were on a walk on patrol.
Oh, yeah.
And you started getting closer and closer and closer to German
helmets.
I was
going the wrong way. And I could see them. They were dug in. They were, I guess, dug in. They were watching us. It was a machine gun. And they were watching me. And I had a, I didn't, they just told me to take this message to, I forget it was the captain or lieutenant. And I started to walk. And I had a rifle on my shoulder. And I started to walk where I was supposed to go. Mm. But as I was going, I kind of looked to my right, and I could notice the helmets in there. I said, holy mackerel, what am I going to do to myself? What am I going to do? So I just kind of bid walking left and whistled. Till I got through, and I went back to our lines, and I reported in. The guy went out, and I said, I just walked almost through the crop lines. So I give him the message. He said, just go wait for sight to move on. You know?
Yeah.
But it was a funny feeling. You see them, but I guess they didn't want to pick me off because one man didn't mean much, you know.
Right.
They wanted to see what's going on. But it's a right. funny feeling. But there's a lot of stuff goes on, like little things like nobody knows about. It happens to different guys, you know. They call us the Bastard Regiment. Another name for Tagalongs. Where's the 160? Oh, you guys that got wiped out there. Well, you know any guys? Yeah, down by that way, you might find some guys in it. What are you going to do? Tag along with us. And a lot of times I was asked something to do, so they tell me, shut your mouth and do what you're told. You wanted a lot of questions. You see, I was what different guy, like a pat troopers. So I'd ask them questions, just shut up and do what you're told. Mm. So I just tagged along with a whole bunch, whatever right. they went. Until we kept on moving around, and we meet some other guy. You got 160? Yeah, okay, come on, let's get together. So finally, I think the ball was pretty well on its way and going good. We had a group together, and one of the corporal aside yelled out, he said, I want all the 106th Infantry Division guys. So we all got up there. So he counted it out, 19 of us. He said, we're going to fight as a division.
19 guys.
Well, we had two regiments that were captured and wiped out.
Right.
And my regiment was the 424th. We were staggering along fighting with anybody, different division. So he said, they recaptured our colors, some farmhouse off the Germans. They recaptured the colors. So that means the division didn't lose its colors. Mm. So we didn't have no more regiments. They were all gone. So he said, we're going to fight as a division, the 104th, 24th Regiment. So when he counted out 19 of us. So how much could we do damage, you know?
Well, as long as you had the colors, it was
official. Well, we were pretty proud about getting the colors back because if you lose your colors in a division, that's it. You don't ever get them back. And then I joined the Battle of the Bulge, and there was a guy from Webster. I remember his wife used to go to the meetings. He come from Webster, kind of a thin guy. And when I went to the parade in Worcester, I finally joined the Battle of the Bulge, where I heard about the other guy. My wife said, why don't you join? I joined. So I met the guy. We were in the parade. He said, what division you come from? I said, 106. Oh, he said, you guys surrendered, huh? I said, no. I said, the 424, we didn't surrender. Oh, he said, yeah, I heard you guys were the Yellow Belly Division. Knocked me for a loop. But like he said, that some general in France wrote a thing about the 106th, how we didn't fight and all like that.
Yeah, man.
And then there was a big article about that. The officers in charge of the 424, 23rd, 22nd Regiment, they gived up. But they had nothing left. They had them break their guns and ammunition. And after all the history went through and all, they said if he wouldn't have surrendered, the Germans would have killed them all.
Mm.
So it was a good thing they did surrender.
Right.
But a lot of guys say, oh, they were yellow, they wouldn't fight. Chris knows what was going on over there. It was almost impossible. Mm.
Christian had mentioned in one of our earlier conversations about the education of the higher officers in the German army and the uneducated average infantryman. Yeah. Tell us about that.
Well, only 10% of the population could go to college by rule of Hitler. And most of them were the upper class and the people with money. So the poor guys, the farmers and the workers, were very uneducated. To contrary to the Americans, who might not have been uneducated, but they were very wise, because in Germany, the poor farmer was lucky to have a bicycle. In the States, they would have an old jalopy that they would repair and maintain. And so they were, and all of these farmers in the States were shooting woodchucks. Therefore, they had weapons. Hitler would not allow civilians to have weapons. Mm. So basically, the American soldier was, first of all, innovative. He knew how to handle weapons. He knew how to handle vehicles. He also worked together. The spirit of togetherness in the States is very prevalent. And the Germans, very stupidly, but thought that if the officers, well, in Germany, if you kill the officer, the men didn't know where they were going.
Right.
So they're always trying to shoot the officers. Well, you could shoot the American officer, the sergeant would take over. You shoot the sergeant, the corporal would take over.
Right.
And the lowest level private would take over.
Right.
And Yankee ingenuity made it such that you take, I'll give you one example. Lyle Bausch, the famous youngest lieutenant in the United States Army, he entered the Army at age 14. He was in the 99th Infantry. Held up a whole German division for a whole day with 18 men. Because they positioned their guns in such a manner that they couldn't move.
Mm.
And they were picking the German officers. And the troops didn't know what to do.
They were disoriented, yeah.
Whilst the Americans, you don't do that.
So the Germans weren't good at thinking outside the box.
That's right, right. Exactly.
And most of the GIs that were PFCs or privates, when they first get into combat, they have corporals, sergeants, lieutenants, captains, and all that. But as the guys get killed off, the lower rank doesn't want to become a corporal. He doesn't want to be the sergeant.
Right, right.
But automatically, he becomes a sergeant.
Right.
And then after a few days, the guys with the less experience, they look to a guy that's a corporal or sergeant. He's got the know-how, like a German officer. If they lost their officer, the other guys, another thing that happened like that in the cold weather, it was so cold like that, some of the Germans that didn't have shoes like that, they would steal American shoes. If you were moving forward and a guy jumped up and you captured him, he had American shoes on, most of the guys would shoot him right there.
So it sounds like the Germans, the average German infantryman, was heavily dependent on guidance from officers.
Oh, yeah.
And the average American went into combat, as you said, maybe not highly educated, but with a certain skill set before they even came into training. They knew how to run a vehicle, they knew how to shoot a weapon.
It's a different upbringing when you're a kid home, you know, like we grew up different, acted different. They were taught to be Superman or stuff like that. And you get a comical GI, that, you know, they joke around, they make fun of things. You had guys take Jeeps towards the end of the war. Take a Jeep and take it apart and put fenders on it. Mm. not fenders, but make it like a car, you know, you would at home.
Right, right.
And if there was something else to do, if there was some makeshift to do it, they would do it.
Right.
See the crazy stuff with a guy.
Make something out of nothing.
Yeah.
One thing that people do not realize is that, and it's very sad, mind you, but it's official. You go back in the records in Washington, and you'll find out that 22% of all our officers were killed by their own men.
Hmm.
22%.
Wow.
Why? Why? These poor kids were sent to OCS, officer training, and they really had no no knowledge, no understanding of war. Mm. So they would go and be assigned to a unit like Chuck was, who had seen war already quite a long time, and they would stand up on the trench and take their binoculars. Where are they? Well, you know, yeah, that's telling the Germans there's somebody there. Right. Right? So they gave instructions that were sometimes
ridiculous. we got replacements towards after. Most of all the guys were killed or captured, lost the officers. Like I was a replacement, but an early replacement. But after the Bulge was over, we got replacements from England, Air Force and all that. We got new officers like that. But when we got new officers, the young guys, they didn't push us. They'd ask, you know, if there was something that they'd ask some of the corporals or sergeants, you think we should do this and that? Because like Chris said, they'd have to watch their back. And some of these guys, like in training, they gung-ho and they'll do this and that. But in combat, you got to watch your step. Mm. And we got new officers. We were supposed to go to town and walk around, and they want to take our rifles away from us. And the officer would say, you want to go to town? I'll let you borrow my 45. Oh, because yeah, towards the end, if you had a weapon, you had to report for every weapon you had, every shell you had. Mm. And if it was curfew, you weren't allowed to talk to Germans. But the officers, instead of being gung-ho, they were kind of going along with what we were saying.
Right.
A lot of the sergeants or something like that become officers. We even had one of the sergeants went back to France for 2 weeks for school. He come back, and it's like a no-no, come back to the company, but he come back to our outfit. He wanted to come back, but now he's an officer.
Left as a sergeant and came back, what rank?
First lieutenant.
First lieutenant.
Yeah. Second lieutenant. Yeah. So, go back with all the guys, and he's buddy, but they kind of break him up because they don't want to send him back to the same outfit because like buddy, friends, you know?
Yeah.
But we did have one guy come back, hey, lieutenant, joking on him.
Well, I'm sure he was probably happy to be back with his friends in the unit.
He didn't want to. He got a battlefield commission. He didn't really want to go, and they said, oh, you're going back to France for a couple of weeks, and
yeah,
he didn't want to. Like I say, a lot of guys that were corporals, and they just say, well, geez, I'd like to become a sergeant or a sergeant first class. In combat, you don't look for it because you're in charge of men. You know, I don't take care of myself, and the other guys have got to take care of you, and you look for things to do. But like I say, we got some of these guys that corporals, they'd pull some of the stuff out you wouldn't believe. Mm. And the German, he could do that, but he'd look around and say, well, what do we do next?
Right, yeah. Right.
It's a lot of buddy-buddy system. Mm. A lot of buddy system.
But it worked.
It worked, yeah. When you don't know where you're at and what you're doing. You got to do what you can do. That's
right, to stay alive.
Yeah.
Did you have all of your meals in a foxhole?
We used to get meals maybe once or two or three days apart. We get K rations, C rations. Never in building the warm homes or buildings like that. It was all outside.
Yep.
If you could get into a blown up building that day, you couldn't build a fire at night because they could see it. But we did build fires in the back, and it was so cold. We had a pants, blouse, we just had the combat boots. And you stand close to a fire, your pants would get all that, you could almost like fall apart. And you get so close to your shoes, before you know you were burning. But there was a way, in a bunker or foxhole, you get together and you huddle. And I think where I save my feet a lot of times, one of the guys told me to take your socks off, rinse them out, and I think I had two extra socks, and I put them in here and cover them.
Yep.
So the afternoon,
my body heat.
Yeah, when my feet were wet and like that, I got a chance, I'd take them off, put new ones on, but I didn't wash them, I just rinse them.
Right.
But I think that's what saved my legs from getting frostbitten, because they were very, very cold. I don't know how most of us got through it. We don't know. Mm. I don't know. It was cold. Okay. It was windy. And there was no pity for nobody. You had to do what you had to do. Mm.
But to answer your question, I don't know if you saw it, but when you were fighting with the paratroopers, sometimes the paratroopers were given a choice. They were so far ahead, you want a meal or ammunition? You can't get both. I'm not kidding.
Make the choice.
Make a choice.
Right.
And it was always ammunition, of course. So they, they stayed without a meal quite often.
Well, as you can see, we have some materials. Christian has brought a number of pieces of art and some maps, and we're going to discuss that now. Christian, why don't you tell us what this is and what it represents?
This is a special panel made by the Belgians in for the 50th anniversary. It says 1944 to 1994, and it shows the American soldier walking on the German flag and heading toward American flag, and you see the Belgian pine trees on both sides, and you also see the snow, of course. And he's dressed up in a camouflage, the sheets that were given by Belgian citizens to the American soldiers.
And we have another piece of artwork which features one of my favorite airplanes of World War II, the P-51 Mustang. Christian, tell us about this.
This is also made in Belgium. It shows the various troops in the Battle of the Bulge. Of course, you must understand that the Battle of the Bulge occurred during the worst winter ever in 50 years in Belgium. Snow, ice, wind, awful weather. And here you see the armor, the American tank, the GI, the P-51, which was usually the high-level support for bombers, the P-47, which was the low-level support of the troops with the fighter bomber. And this is the, it's really, and oh yes, I must remember Ardennes, 1944. Ardennes is the section of Belgium and Luxembourg called the Ardennes, which is the where the Battle of the Bulge occurred.
And lastly, we have a map which will show the front lines for the Battle of the Bulge. And I'll turn it over to Christian, who will tell us about that.
This is Belgium. You have the Netherlands in the north, the Germany over here, Luxembourg in yellow, and France over here. This is Massachusetts, and I put the exact dimension of the Battle of the Bulge, square yard per square yard, literally, and it shows what if you had to fight the Battle of the Bulge in Massachusetts. Here's the Cape, there's the Atlantic, New Hampshire, Rhode Island, Connecticut, and there's the Battle of the Bulge.
And where are we at this point?
And here is the Quabbin Reservoir.
The Quabbin Reservoir?
Yeah.
So basically, all of Boston, all of Metro West,
yes,
and all the way out to the Quabbin Reservoir.
Yeah. And you had 44 divisions fighting in that area, multiplied by 17,000 men. That tells you a little bit about the problems faced.
Well, I would like to thank you both for coming in and talking to us. I enjoyed the conversation. I hope you guys did. And I'm sure that the folks at home probably enjoyed hearing your stories. And I'd like to thank you. Thank you for
You're
coming
welcome.
In. Thank you for everything you've done. And thank you for your service, Chuck.
Okay.
And that brings us to the end of Day Trip to History. And thank you for watching. I'm Bob DeToma. And remember, we're all living history right now.